Pass in the West are often presented by Hollywood in the most outrageously wrong ways. Today, we're at Fort Union in the eastern part of New Mexico. We'll look at this fort briefly. The first, second, and third forts. What you have here behind me are the ruins of the third fort. Apologies about the wind. It's a nice big breeze out here, and it's going to be terrible in the sound, unfortunately. But what we're going to do is take a look at this fort, and of course, think about it in relation to the other videos we're making in this region. How the troops from here are the ones that fight the battle at Glorieta Pass. Behind me, just where the end of the grassy land goes over into the tree cover, was the first Fort Union, constructed in 1851 to guard the Santa Fe Trail. The two branches coming down here, converging, and then continuing in that direction to Santa Fe itself. Strategically important location outside of the cities in this region. What do you have? However, is a wooden construction. Wood taken from the mountains on the other side, brought over, badly constructed. By the time of the American Civil War, the fort is falling apart. At that stage, the commander of the fort, as well as the commander coming south from Colorado, decides that this strategic location cannot just rely on that falling apart fort. They build a star fort and Burson fort over there, which we'll look at next, to guard this confluence of the Santa Fe trails. This is the remains of the star fort. See the ditches, see a little bit of outlines. I'll put a satellite image on top to kind of give you a better perspective of the outlines of this fort. It's a really easy constructed thing, but it's where the defense of the Santa Fe Trail. It's a small garrison that was here, some New Mexico volunteers. Very little remains, however, today, but it is an important part of these fortifications. Star Fort, here behind us. At the time of the Civil War, Major of the U.S. Infantry, Gabriel Paul, was in command of Fort Union. In December of 1861, he received also a commission as a colonel in the 4th New Mexico Volunteers. So he has two ranks, as is very common during the Civil War for regular officers who for Waltz a part of the volunteers. He wants to hold his position, keep his force here. It is only a small force of regulars, after all. At the same time, as he hears about the rebel forces getting into Santa Fe, he gets more desperate. He demands that Colonel Slaw, who's coming down from Colorado, advance, move faster. In a blizzard, they advance all the way down here. The sad reality, however, is, as Paul says, we'll stay here, we'll defend, Slaw says, we'll advance on the rebels and take them out before they get here. Unfortunately for Paul, Slaw outranks them by 4 months. It is then that 1,200 men of Colorado volunteers, as well as yours regulars, leave here and make their way to Glorieta Pass. Talks about the battle in a different video. Colonel Slaw, after the quote-unquote victory, withdraws, resigns, and leaves. Many of his Coloradians remain here. Some of them will go up the branches of the Santa Fe Trail after the battle. Some of them will make it into Missouri and Kansas, fighting the war in that region. Some of them will unfortunately be involved in the conflict against Native Americans at Sand Creek, where they massacre hundreds of peaceful Cheyenne. With that, the Civil War story at Fort Union ends, and the construction of the third fort begins behind us in that direction. We'll take a look at that next, and also look at how this fort became a national monument. Battle of Glorieta Pass. When Brigadier General Carlton takes over command of this region following Canby's reassignment to the Eastern Theater, he orders the construction of the Third Fort Union. This fort is going to be much more sturdily built than its first predecessor. It's adobe bricks. They're going to be clad in. Tin roofs on top, it's gonna last. It's the intention that this fort is gonna last. It's in 1868 that the fort's construction is complete. Of course, now we have the ruins behind us. We have to imagine it as a much more prominent, much more active facility with hundreds of men and thousands of civilians in passing through active here. Contrast to what Hollywood wants us to sing about Western forts, Fort Union has no palisaded wall around it. In 1891, the U.S. military decides that Fort Union is no longer necessary and closes the outpost down. By that point in 1891, when the U.S. military closes down Fort Union, hardly any forces remain here. Land reverts back to the Ames Butler Company, which has bought the Moran land grant, and cattle start grazing on this land. The local population comes here to find building materials, and the fort very quickly falls into ruins. It's going to take a while before the local community, as well as the Park Service and the state of New Mexico, decide that this place, of the Santa Fe Trail's branch lines, part of the Battle of Glorieta Pass, matters enough that it needs preservation. As we stand here in the ruins of Fort Union, it's important to remind, as early as 1929, the local population wanted to preserve this. Congress was National Park Service was interested. The local population was interested. But as so often, unfortunately, with parks of this nature, Congress didn't act. Initial bills died in committee. By the time it was a new deal, agencies stood ready to move in and do work here, but Congress didn't act. In 1949, the state passed a law where they were ready to use eminent domain to take over this property, as the landowner had also been an obstacle to the preservation of this land. Getting the message, the landowners finally said, okay, we'll give this land up. And it's in 1954 that Fort Union National Monument comes into existence. The great benefit for Fort Union at that stage is that the National Park Service has just initiated what becomes known as Mission 66. And immediately there's money for the visitor center, for housing, and for some of the preservation work needed to stabilize the walls. There's no reconstruction, unfortunately, granted to Fort Union, which leaves us with this. Also, when a wall comes down, as a result, unfortunately, it is not being put up again. Maybe in the future, Congress can change that. But for now, Fort Union is crumbling in front of our eyes. We're standing here in front of one of our buildings, and it's a perfect location, I think, to kind of talk about what the National Park Service got when Fort Union is established as a national monument. They had to quickly act to preserve as best as they could what remained. And sadly, that meant large excavators at times were used to preserve these walls, to stabilize them. A lot of archaeology, unfortunately, got lost at the Park Service, definitely, I think, would have liked to have today. On the other hand, of course, we have these adobe bricks coated in walls. And there has been a lot of work over the decades trying to figure out how best to preserve this, stabilize them, replace broken pieces. As in so many other locations where adobe is used, moisture is the biggest enemy. The weather, the elements are a major factor in the preservation of this site. Hopefully the future holds a lot good for this fort.
What are you seeing here is the National Park Service making adobe bricks at Pecos National Historical Site. You're also seeing to the sides there how they're creating this wall with sensors inside of it to figure out what moisture levels they're dealing with.
As we end our visit to Fort Union, I'm just going to give you a solo video episode. I'll give you a couple of video clips of the rest of the sides, the barracks, the quartermaster's storage buildings, and the rest of what remains.